Barack Obama this week told us we were going to get 2,500 Marines based in Darwin in a big reordering of American priorities.
I have therefore made a deliberate and strategic decision. As a Pacific nation, the United States will play a larger and long-term role in shaping this region and its future.
But for Julia Gillard, this was probably the gold.
In my friend Julia, I see the quality that we Americans admire most in our Australian friends. Somebody who's down to earth, easy to talk to, and who says it like it is, straight up.
To sort the style from the substance, I'm joined by former Defence Minister Peter Reith and former Ambassador Richard Broinowski, also a critic of Australia's trade in uranium. Peter, has Obama's trip been oversold? And we were talking about a mere 2,500 Marines in Darwin. I mean, this is a world superpower. That does seem a very small force.
It was a great week for the spin masters, let's face it. There's nothing new about it. I mean, look, I welcome it. I think it's good the Americans are doing what they're doing. I think it's good that we're doing something on India. I think it's good the Marines, the Free Trade Pact, they're all positive things, of course they are, but they're all liberal policies. I mean, there's nothing new. And, you know, for Kevin Rudd to be backgrounding, you know, to get stuck into Julia, but saying that he was the one behind the Marines. Look, the coalition people would put that to the Americans in Osmond in 2006 or 2005. I mean, it's been around for years. The same with the other two things. So, no, look, spin masters. You know, I've had a great week. The Australian media, basically more left-wing than right-wing, they are swinging in behind Julia.
Loved it. Look, we can get rid of this inquiry
into the press. I mean, don't worry. It's, you know, the problem's fixed. They've all gone back to where they usually are, and they've given her a huge, you know, lift this week, or attempted to give her a big lift. I'm not sure it'll work, but come back.
It'll work a bit, I think.
Yeah, but it'll give them something. Yeah.
You must have been really wondering. This is supposed to be one superpower confronting Chinese growing might with, what, 2,500 Marines
Let's remember, Andrew, that the Americans had a small force in South Korea just along the 38th parallel. That was a tripwire. That was a tripwire. If the North had come south, they would have brought in more forces. And you could put it in the same terms. It's not the number of troops they have, and don't forget the US Marines, but it's the fact that we have a force there, and in our realignment of forces, we're bringing forces out of Okinawa, where they're not popular at all.
There's, what, 40, 50, 60,000 coming down
to Australia. Some of them are going to Guam. But as I say, it's a token, it's a tripwire, it's a redefinition, a reallocation of American forces around the region.
I wonder whether it's oversold, though, Richard.
Quite obviously, it's part of the confrontation of China, the containment of China. This is what it's all about. Obama explained that. And it's not just the Liberal Party that's wanted this. The Labor Party also can't wait to have American troops on Australian soil.
So when you're talking about a tripwire, it's a
bipartisan policy. Yeah.
But when you're talking about a tripwire, essentially what you're saying, you could do the same job if you handcuffed American backpackers to Darwin installations. It's like, oh, well, you touch one of us, then we'll come to war. That's what you're really saying.
Training as a US Marine, Andrew, that's the important thing. These Marines are very tough people.
I wonder, 2,500.
One of the things that hasn't been discussed is the status of forces. We have these people up in Darwin. What happens if there are crimes committed? And there are crimes committed by forces all over the world, not just Americans. Do we say, all right, take them out and give them American jurisdiction, or are they going to be tried in Australia? This hasn't even been looked at.
Well, this is a really good point because, you know, it reminds me to say, you know, the press have been out there spinning for the Labor Party, you know, for every last ounce they could get out of it. Now, imagine if John Howard was a Prime Minister and he said, oh, we're going to have 50 Marines. All hell would break loose. And there's Julia. Look, I think it's good that she wants to be friends with Barack Obama. But don't forget, if you go back a few years, one of the big issues where the Labor Party was absolutely hot to trot on John Howard and the US was Guantanamo Bay. Now, it was promised to be closed. It wasn't closed. Mm. Did you see that little Adam Bandt as he was falling over himself to shake hands with Barack Obama? Did you hear him say, oh, by the way, Mr. President, what about Guantanamo Bay? Did you hear that, Bob Brown? Happy to, you know, attack, you know, a US president in the parliament, but there he is basically on all four, you know, hands and legs.
It's really amazing. It has been extraordinary, the hype, and I don't know that we've actually examined. What is the the nature of the Chinese threat. Well, we needed this militaristic tone and the 2,500.
Let me explain something here. The threat is the Spratlys and Paracels in the South China Sea. Now, you know, Malaysia, Vietnam, Indonesia, Philippines claim these as well. But the fact is that those islands, between 1932 and 1935, the Chinese government named those islands and owned them. Now, after the Chai Coms replaced the Chinats, the Chai Coms said the same thing. These are our islands. The other countries weren't even thought of. They are colonies of the European powers. Suddenly, they come in with their own claims. 28 of them are occupied by Vietnam right now, only 8 by China. The Chinese have been fairly restrained about this.
Yeah, but do you really see that a conflict over who owns these islands is going to degenerate into a conflict between China and America on the high seas, where Darwin becomes a pivot point?
Well, I don't. I think that we should have a much more disinterested policy about the whole thing, much less concerned about military confrontation in the region. And this is what worries me. You know, China's our great trading partner. That's why we're all here today with the standard of living we have. America is our great and powerful friend. These two countries could be in conflict. Where do we stand?
Well, I'll tell you where we stand, mate. We stand with the United States. Because they are true believers in free trade. They're also truly democratic, and we share values with them. But, Andrew,
the only point is why our decision to sell uranium to India is good too.
The Americans told Julie she had to change her silly policy, and I'm glad she took notice of it. Well, I can't prove it, of course not, but I mean they have been totally opposed to it until, you know, the last few months. Can we just put this though on a rational basis? This decision about having Marines is not based on the reality of a threat. That is not the situation. No one is saying that China is a threat. What we are saying, though, is, and this is where I really do agree with the government and with the Americans, and that is we do need to have in place a capability to defend ourselves. And the reality that the Americans are prepared to be with us, I think, is a good thing. And if that develops over time with nuclear-powered subs coming into Stirling and WA or, you know, a base in the future, I'm not saying it's about to happen, but those things, in my view, got nothing to do with China in one sense or anybody else. This is about Australia always being prepared. It's also our insurance policy. You don't know what's going to happen in the future. And, look, there are lots of lefties, Richard and others, you know, who say, oh, look, what are you worried about, you know, and let's be...
Let's not categorise people. Are you a
progressive lefty? That's fine.
Are you a righty? I'm the lefty in the middle of you. But seriously, Richard,
I want to ask you about something else that might have offended you. As a professional, former professional diplomat and as someone who opposes our sale of uranium, the decision to sell uranium to India overturns something that Kevin Rudd, I think, foolishly put in place 4 years ago. He was not even consulted. And oddly enough, I thought it was a bit unprofessional of him, he went on to the 7:30 program on the ABC to actually underline that point, just in case you're in any doubt about that. Let's listen to it.
In terms of when the Prime Minister communicated with the Indian government, the truthful answer to your question is no, I was not consulted.
Well, what did you make of him having a dummy spit?
Well, I can only say that I'm glad I wasn't working on Kevin Rudd's staff when this decision was made, because surely he is the foreign minister and surely the Prime Minister should have consulted him. I agree with that entirely.
Particularly since he was in India.
Yeah, and he is the foreign minister of Australia. But, you know, let's go back to 1998 when both Pakistan and India exploded quite a number of nuclear weapons. The Liberal government, the Liberal Party, was foaming at the mouth about this and saying how terrible it was and how we had to punish both of these countries. Now we've got a situation where Peter and his colleagues are saying we should have been exporting uranium to India a long time ago. Mm-hmm. The fact is, what it does is it compromises, it takes away a fundamental principle that we have adhered to ever since Malcolm Fraser handed this down in Parliament in 1976. We will have safeguards attaching to our uranium sales, and every country we sell to must be a member of the NPT. There are three that are not: Pakistan, India and Israel.
And but we're now, sending it now to, India we're selling away our uranium to China right now, which proliferates. Yes, but, I mean, what? But this India, is a dead treaty, isn't
it? No, it's not a dead treaty at all. It's the best treaty, it's the best and only treaty we've got.
We're selling it to Russia.
188 members of this treaty, and it has stopped Argentina, Brazil from going nuclear, South Africa from going nuclear. There's been a whole break on proliferation.
I'm not so sure that treaty is sufficient when you get China being sold our uranium.
But look, this
China has agreed to produce fissile material.
Well, Richard makes two points. His first is you've got to have safeguards. His second point is you've got to have a particular treaty. Well, I think in the real world, one treaty, as far as I'm concerned, or a set of agreements or some other deal, quite frankly, just because it's the UN one doesn't itself make it, a better operation. The fact of the matter is there is an agreement already entered into by the Indians with the US, which set off this whole possibility. And as far as the conditionality of it, that is, and safeguards, that is totally part of this package. Always was when we announced this policy and Labor abandoned it. And so in terms of getting a good outcome, I don't disagree with you on the first part of what you say, but just because it's a UN treaty and just because Kevin wants to be on the Security Council,
One thing. Gentlemen, unfortunately, time defeats us, which is a real shame. Richard Broinowski and Peter Reith, thank you so much for joining us. We'll argue later in the break.